Greene's motion to vacate, or do you stand behind Speaker Johnson?
We're getting along very well with the Speaker, and I get along very well with Marjorie. We have a Speaker. He was voted in, and it was a complicated process, and I think it's not an easy situation for any Speaker. I think he's doing a very good job. He's doing about as good as you're going to do, and I'm sure that Marjorie understands that. She's a very good friend of mine, and I know she has a lot of respect for the Speaker.
He said a lot there. Don't know if any of that's true. But Speaker Mike Johnson met former President Donald Trump at Mar-a-Lago today. They discussed their major announcement on election integrity as he tries to corral a deeply divided majority. Trump, who had been at odds with Johnson over FISA's reauthorization earlier this week, did endorse the current Speaker of the House. He hinted that the leading anti-Johnson hater, Marjorie Taylor Greene, does as well. Now, that's despite what Marge said literally just hours before the Mar-a-Lago event.
Because they see me up close. They know I mean exactly every single word I say. And I'm not full of just like Mike Johnson is. And I'm actually going to follow through with actions instead of lie to people on television and in press conferences and out on the campaign trail.
Is she talking about Trump? Is she talking about Johnson? I don't know. Cenk, what are your thoughts on, I mean, she's on a short leash with Trump. They're in constant communication. Where do we go from here?
Yeah, that was hilarious. Because Trump's like, I'm sure Marjorie Taylor Greene respects Mike Johnson. Marjorie Taylor Greene's like, no, I don't. I really, really don't. I think he's full of crap. Okay. All right, well, that's clear. So, pausing here to deliver some honest truth as we do in our news coverage as well. TYT is facing challenges, guys, as the entire industry is. You know who could make the difference? You. If you hit the join button below, it's gonna make all the difference and keep us in business. We appreciate you, thank you. Look, my guess as to what's gonna happen next is Marjorie Taylor Greene is gonna start to back off. Because why did Mike Johnson go to Mar-a-Lago? For exactly that question being asked. So Trump standing next to him could say, no, he's all right, okay? So what did Trump get out of Mike Johnson? I'm not quite sure yet, but there is, you know, he loves it when people come and kiss his ass, and I mean, ring. And so he gets on his hands and knees and grovels, and he's got the Speaker of the House groveling to him. Maybe that's enough, maybe he asked for something else. Mike Johnson just did justify him on the FISA situation, which could explain in a second. But overall, Trump has decided, no, Mike Johnson's good enough, he should stay the Speaker. And so Marjorie Taylor Greene is now off the reservation. My guess is she'll come back on. On FISA real quick, Trump was right. So, you can't say that, you're on the left. No, remember, we on the left are not in favor of FISA. Trump's a Johnny come lately because he thinks they spied in on him. I don't think they did. But they do spy in on regular Americans, and that's why we're thrilled that it lost the first time around. But Mike Johnson, of course, found enough establishment Democrats to back him, so they were able to defeat Trump and the progressives on that issue. So it's interesting that after that vote, they had this press conference. But in terms of Marjorie Taylor Greene versus Johnson, Johnson seems to have won this round.
I think it's pretty priceless that the two of them are meeting to discuss election integrity. And you know what's happened more and more with the Republican Party? It's like every single thing they say they advance, they actually do the opposite on, right? Like, we're all for election integrity, yet I keep claiming falsely that the election was stolen. You know, he says we have a speaker who was voted in. I just kept repeating again, and in my mind, he actually would say, we have a President Biden who was voted in correctly. So no, I mean, just with that aside, I think it just speaks to the self-serving nature of how Trump functions, how Johnson functions, and also how Trump is the person who has power to potentially rein in people like Marjorie Taylor Greene for his own purposes. So, you know, just those are thoughts, yeah.
Yeah, Ramesh, I think you hit it there. The point about election integrity is a good one. It might be what Trump is getting out of this deal is, you see that I now control the entire Republican Party. Yeah. So I brought in the Speaker of the House here, not only to grovel in front of the cameras to me, but on top of that, now he is telling everybody, I won the election last time around. I've got every Republican politician doing exactly the lie that I want them to do. Because I didn't like losing last time. But here's the Speaker of the House telling us that I didn't lose and going along with that fiction. So maybe that's why he won this round rather than Marjorie Taylor Greene.
Yeah, and from an analytical perspective, it does speak to Trump's absolute dominance over the Republican Party, right? That he could have both bending the knee toward him at the same time, right? Yeah. And I do think that's why this is ultimately about defeating Trump.
But do you both believe that he didn't already have them eating out of his hand, doing whatever he wants? I'm still confused, and I think Jake, you make great points, but what can Mike Johnson, who's constantly walking this political tightrope with a gun to his head and another one, one to the temple, one to the back, what can he really do for Trump? Is that enough to stand there and look foolish and talk about election integrity? Is that enough for Trump?
No, Shannon, that's a great point, and I'm not sure. Maybe there's something else behind this deal too that we'll find out later, because even if you add those things up, it might not be enough, because Sharon makes a great point. I mean, Johnson was a groveler to begin with. Marjorie Taylor Greene is a little bit more of a mad dog, but at the end of the day, there is a leash, and Trump just pulled it, and you'll all get to see with your own eyes. Is she an independent actor and she's gonna defy Trump? Well, okay, we'll see, right? Or is she gonna get back in line? And Sharon's also right that Mike Johnson has a very tough line to toe. I have no sympathy for him. The reason it's tough is because he has to please the establishment and give them whatever they want, the warrantless wiretapping, money to Israel, whatever the establishment, tax cuts for the rich. Of course, that's the whole point of the Republican Party, right? He has to do all those things. And he's a religious zealot, so he tries to sneak that in every once in a while. And then he has to do whatever Trump wants. So he's like, okay, the election was stolen, I guess, and the mules, and okay, what else do I need to do? But I have no sympathy, because brother, you're saying, well, I have a tough time lying to you guys in three different ways.
Yeah.
I don't care. Yeah. No, sorry. Yeah, no sympathy.
You're right that he has to really stitch it all together. But I also think, everybody has to remember that Trump, even though he's populist and erratic in many different ways, his policies were policies that were absolutely pro oligarchy, pro elite, right? Like the biggest tax cuts in the history of this country, 98% of which benefited the top 1%. So rhetorically and behaviorally and kind of pathetically in certain ways, or in a petty kind of soap opera way, Trump is very erratic and populist, but many of the policies are policies that are the extreme harsh versions of Republican policies, over recent memory.
100%. Yeah. Last quick point here. Trump's a fake populist, right? But you have to give him credit. He's a good actor, right? Because people think like, oh man, he's so authentic. Why? Because he goes off the teleprompter. The rest of the robots are like, I will tell you about the economic upturn, downturn, whatever the prompter wrote. And Trump's like, let me tell you something, okay? I've got this dog, and I got him on the leashes. And we're like, well, that sounds honest. I mean, he's saying crazy things, and he's definitely off prompter. But don't look at what he says, look at what he does. Remember, he's a legendary con man. He's been pretending to be a good businessman this entire time, when every company he's ever run in the past has gone bankrupt. Like six giant companies he bankrupted. He just has his small properties left now. He doesn't have anywhere near the money that he used to have, because he's been playing a successful businessman. Yep. He's mainly just an actor. And so, the policies have all benefited the mega rich and giant corporate interests.
And you know what, Cenk? This is something Trump's done for such a long time so effectively. I remember in eighth grade, I was asked to write a report about Donald Trump in my class. When I was in eighth grade.
Yeah. So it's a long story.
But 30 years ago.
But back then, his dad made all the money. That's the first $413 million that Trump lost, was his dad's money. Okay, but he would go in front of every camera and be like, I'm the most successful businessman. And the reporters were all reported, most successful businessman. I'm like, You guys not see what's actually happening? Like, that's company number four that went bankrupt. Company number five, company number six. But every time he goes in front of the camera and plays, acts like he's a successful businessman. And obviously NBC spectacularly helped him with that acting job by making him the head of The Apprentice, where he played a successful billionaire, even though he never was one.
And it plays rhetorically really well to American mythology, including in that era, right? That was the era that that movie Wall Street came out, right? Where Michael Douglas was just being saying greed is good, playing Gordon Gekko. So he sort of fit that archetype. He's fit that archetype for decades.
That's such a good point. Yeah. I never thought about it that way. Ramesh is referring to the original press conferences that he used to do. And I think that he probably was modeling himself after Gordon Gekko. I never even thought about that.
Yeah.
It's a great point.
With Charlie Sheen and all.
Yep. Yeah, and I mean, just don't forget the music that introduced The Apprentice. And then we're learning now that OJ's gone that Trump wanted him on. Only NBC said, no, we're not gonna have the acquitted double murderer on The Apprentice. But yeah, that's, I wanna know what your paper said in the eighth grade about Donald Trump. You still have access to it, Ramesh?
Oh, no. If I did find it, I'm gonna put that away.
No, we want to see it. Why didn't I want to see it?
I'm sure I was praising him. We all drank the Kool-Aid. We're immigrant kids, you know? We all drank the Kool-Aid on so many things. So much of the hype machine.
No.
Go
to tyt.com/perks. We're going to put that, finding that and publishing it as one of the perks.
We'll like auction it off.
Okay.
Thanks for watching The Young Turks. Really appreciate it. Another way to show support is through YouTube memberships. You'll get to interact with us more. There's live chat emojis, badges. You've got emojis of me, Anna, John, JR. So those are super fun. But you also get playback of our exclusive member only shows and specials right after they air. So all of that, all you gotta do is click that join button right underneath the video. Thank you.